Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner. I am available for code reviews and on-site training. And well, since someone recently asked this in a video, yes, people actually do hire me for on-site training, and I've had quite a busy schedule this year, which has been great. Now, before I get to the meat of this episode, I do want to mention as quickly as possible that if you are watching this episode before C++ on C 2024, then I am giving my Understanding Object Lifetime workshop at C++ on C. You only have 1 week left at the time of the airing of this episode to buy those tickets and decide to come to the conference. If you're in Europe and not able to make C++ on C, then I will also be at NDC Tech Town giving a C++ best practices workshop. And finally, I will be giving an applied const expert workshop at C++ under the C. And if you haven't checked out C++ under the C yet, you really should. It is a one-day conference, 2 days including the workshops, in Breda, Netherlands, in the first year ever in 2024 out of October, coming up here soon. Okay, let's get to the meat of this episode, and that is the amazing new -WNRVO warning that GCC has just deployed. Now, this is still on trunk, actually. I don't believe there's any released version at the time of recording of this episode that has this warning. Now, the point of the warning is to let you know when named return value optimization could not be applied and you thought that it should be applied. So let's do a very simple example. As C++ developers, we are honored to contribute to self-driving technology, simplify lives with embedded devices, support financial ecosystems, and assist traders with trading bots. To keep up with the pace of development, we need tools that help us work quickly and effectively. CLion is a powerful JetBrains IDE for C and C++ that makes this challenge its main goal, integrating code analysis, refactoring, and the best ecosystem tools into our day-to-day development. Use CPP Weekly CLion to get 25% off when you purchase a new CLion subscription or renew your existing one. Now, this is a very straightforward example, and I would expect return value optimization to apply here. I'm going to make sure that this warning is explicitly enabled. It is -WNRVO. And I do expect that this will always have return value optimization or named return value optimization. And I don't really like either of those terms because, well, really, it just kind of comes down to how compilers work, and it doesn't necessarily even require optimization levels to be turned on to get the value that you would expect here. Now, the simpler case, which is actually required as of C++ 17, if I am constructing the object in the return statement, then it must be return value optimization. Now, if you don't know, what this means is the compiler is not allowed to perform a copy or a move in line 9. So if I were to call this function, I know that in the lifetime of executing this program, or in the course of executing this program, exactly one string will have existed here. It's absolutely required as of C++ 17. Okay, now where we start to get into trouble is when we might have more than one possible string returned. And this is the kind of thing that I actually just went over with some students in on-site training at an organization just last week. So I know that this is going to do what I expect it to do here. So notice this, not alighting copy on return. Now, technically, this should actually be alighting the move because of as of C++ 11, this is an implicit move when I'm returning a named value from a function, but whatever. So I don't even have to call it. And I get this analysis, not alighting copy on return. So the problem is I have two potential values that I might return from this function. And the compiler has to decide at compile time which one of these things it's going to apply this return value optimization thing to. And that's because it has to know where the return value is going to be stored. So when return value optimization is applied, the return value is actually constructed in place at the call site, and there's just ever one object that has ever existed. Now, if I have one of two possible identifiers that might be returned, the compiler just simply has no way of knowing which one to apply this return value optimization to. Now, I have warnings as errors. Let's go ahead and disable that so that we can actually look at this a little bit more closely. All right, now in the next version here, I'm going to construct the string locally. Now, it still doesn't know which one of these things that it might apply the return value optimization to, so I'm still going to get that warning. But if I put them both in narrow scope, then I see that it is still not applying return value optimization to val2. Now, I know from playing around with this that Clang actually does know how to apply return value optimization in both branches here, because it can see, well, in branch 1, I have exactly one string that is being created and one string that is being returned, and in branch 2, I have exactly one string that is created and exactly one string that might be returned. Therefore, the compiler is able to apply return value optimization to both of these, and GCC certainly plausibly could do that here. It would basically treat val1, val2, and the return value as all being the same object. But GCC isn't, so we have the warning. And now this is the point of this warning. If you're constructing your code in such a way that you are relying on return value optimization and you're not getting it, then this is an absolutely amazing diagnostic that you might want to apply to your code. I'm not yet ready to say it would be a best practice to apply this, but I am saying this is something that you should enable and test in your code and see what is happening. All right, so how do we fix this code? And the way to fix this, if we know that we might return hello or world, and this goes back to many episodes that I've done before, like the optimal way to return from a function and how to write code that avoids copies and moves. And it basically comes down to knowing the rules of the language and knowing that in C++ 17, I am required to have return value optimization in the case where I am constructing the object in the return statement, like this. So I am not going to get a warning from GCC here, I can say rather confidently, because it's not allowed to not do return value optimization. Now, in case you're thinking that this is all too simple, let's just be clear that you can definitely layer these things on and have some level of guarantee that they're going to do what you want them to do. Functions are amazing. I can use functions in very clean, composable ways, and I might do something like this. Notice I'm just passing this value forward, and then I know I'm going to get named return value optimization here, and RVO is required here. So if I know these rules, I can apply them in this great composable way that is super efficient. It's literally the most efficient thing that you can do when constructing values in C++. And then if I really, really wanted to, I could do something like this and actually mutate that thing on line 43, and I'm still only ever have one string that existed. For example, I can update this example on line 51, and I know that I'm going to get exactly one string that ever had its life live. It's going to be equal to either hello Bob or world Bob, but in either case, I get required return value optimization on line 37, I get named return value optimization on line 44, and I have this amazing diagnostic from GCC that helps me structure my code in such a way that I know that I'm going to get these things that I so desperately want from my good, clean, composable, maintainable C++ code. So I hope you enjoyed this episode of C++ Weekly, And this is just a little bit of a taste in my style of teaching. If you were to come to one of those workshops that I mentioned, or if you were to have me on site at your company, students ask questions, we explore things, we look at the tools that are available, and we really break them down, and I prove to you that the thing is doing what I say that it's doing. And we always take the class in whatever direction makes sense for you, your organization, your team. So I hope to see you at one of these upcoming workshops, and thank you for watching C++ Weekly. Be sure to subscribe.